said it's all one day. I threw it all away, took my leap with no goodbye. I bought some company, bragged how we were free, laughed and looked death in the eye. Even far away, in a foreign place, where the hunger gnawed my soul, still my heart would long for love's old sweet song, and a fire when the nights were cold. There's a road somewhere, there's an open door, there's a hill where the green grass grows. There's a family feast where there's joy and peace. Going back to a place called home. Fickle friends are gone, wasted years are long, and regret can bring you low. But there's a swift embrace, there's a
I invite you to take your bulletins and turn to the back page for our responsive reading. You remember in Psalms 119 what it says about the Holy Scriptures. Thy word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Let's enjoy God's glorious light through reading of his word. Lori will lead us, and I will join the congregation in the bold print.
Break forth into song, O mountains and forests and every tree.
Israel has been saved by the Lord with an everlasting salvation.
It was our weaknesses he carried, and our sorrows that weighed him down.
Yet we ourselves thought him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted.
He was wounded, pierced, crushed for our sins.
The chastening for our well-being fell upon him, and by his scourging we are healed.
All of us, like sheep, have strayed away. We each have followed our own path.
But the Lord has caused our iniquity to fall on him.
Let all the world look to me for salvation, for I am God, there is none other.
You will not be put to shame or humiliated to all eternity.
I have wiped out your transgressions like a thick cloud, and your sins like a heavy mist. I am the Lord, there is no other Savior.
Holy, 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 holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory.
How many of you have children? Can I see your hands? Well, look around. Most of you have children. What would you do for your child? Tell me, what would you do? Anything, absolutely anything. There's nothing you would not do. Do you remember the first time you saw your child when they gave you your child at the hospital and you grabbed your little baby and you could not believe that this baby was in your image? Do you remember the countless nights you spent trying to see if he was still breathing? Do you remember when you arrange that beautiful room for him or her in your room and hang all kinds of ridiculous looking things from the ceiling? So that when your baby woke up, they would see beautiful things moving and making noises? There's nothing in life like having a child. You know, I was blessed with parents who instilled in me the love of Jesus Christ. When I was 4 years old, my father was an evangelist. This was back in Argentina. That's the accent you hear is from Argentina. And in Argentina, at that time, 4 years old, my father and my mother would go and establish a new church. So they would go 2 months, they would prepare the place, 2 months, the tent meetings, 2 months, they would establish a new church, and we would move on to the next place and do the same thing another 6 months. But I remember one day, specifically, in the middle of La Pampa in Argentina, we were in a little town called Huatrache, and we were living in a mud house. And my mother said to me, "You know, Lisi," that's my nickname, "today I'm going to do something special for you because there's not much for you to do in this town. I'm going to borrow a bike, a bicycle. And even though it's a large bicycle and you can't ride it, I'm going to take you. You're going to sit in the back, and I'm going to take you to see the wheat fields around this little town." I was so excited because I hadn't done much in that town. So we went out. And very soon, we were outside the village, the town, and we were watching the wheat fields. We were miles away. And all of a sudden, the road got a little hard, so I started kind of falling. And she says, "Lisi, come on, straighten up." So I moved myself in the back seat, and then I started crying. But not just a cry. It was a desperate cry. It was something had gone terribly wrong, and my mother didn't know what it was. So she stopped the bike, looked at me. Nothing looked wrong. So she said, "What's wrong?" And I couldn't talk. I kept pointing to my feet. And so she stopped, took my socks off, and along with my sock came half of my foot. What happened is I had put my little leg inside the ongoing wheel. And I remember, like if it was a photo, looking at my own foot and seeing the half of my foot was missing and seeing the white bone. I still have it in my head. I knew I was going to die. I was sure because we were in the middle of the wheat fields in the middle of nowhere. And I couldn't ride. I couldn't do anything. I had become fully handicapped. But aside from knowing that I would die, I had one other knowledge that my mother could do for me what I could not do for myself. My mother, with strength that I'm sure came from above, she sat me on the main little seat of this bicycle. And she grabbed the bicycle and started running next to it for miles. I don't know how many miles this was. I don't remember. Until we got to town. And that day, she saved my life. I have a little scar left, you know, because I was young enough that the foot rebuilt itself. Today, I'm going to share with you what our Heavenly Father has done. And if it is easy to understand what you would do for a child if he got in trouble or if he fell in a pool or if she, you know, damaged her leg like I did, if it is easy to understand that an earthly father or mother would do that, I don't understand why it has been so hard for us to believe in the gospel. Why it has been so hard to understand that Christ has done for us what was needed and has actually saved us. And that on the cross, we actually see a salvation that we spell D-O-N-E, done. Today, we're going to spend some time with a topic that has become the topic that changed my life and my ministry, which I will spend quite a bit explaining to you today. But we are really going to need your Bibles today. So please grab your Bibles. Grab any paper you can find. I see that your bulletins have some room for you to make some notes. So grab your bulletins. Grab a pen. We're going to start by going over the Gospel of Luke. Elder Nelson mentioned the Gospel of Luke last night. We're actually going to spend 5 minutes on the Gospel of Luke, then we're going to go to our main topic. So I'm going to wait for you to actually grab your Bibles. We're going to go from Genesis to Revelation this morning together, and we're going to learn a lot. And we're going to let the golden thread that goes from the beginning to the end of the Bible so that maybe we can finally understand fully what Christ did for us as much as we can understand on this side of eternity, and then get so excited that you won't be able to stop this fountain that the gospel will become inside of you. So, we're ready? Have your Bibles? Your notes? Okay. We're going to start with the Gospel of Luke. Let's write a few things about this gospel that has been called the Gospel of Amazement, because everybody's amazed in the Gospel of Luke. When people get good news in the Gospel of Luke, every time, either the shepherds or Mary or Elizabeth, everybody's leaping with joy. They leap, they sing, they shout woohoo all the time. The Gospel of Luke is like a big party understanding the good news. So we are going to learn a little bit about this gospel before we get there because we're going to end our sermon in the Gospel of Luke. The Gospel of Luke is the most inclusive gospel of all of them. Is the one that wants everyone to know that they're included in the kingdom of God, no matter who they are or where they've been. So you know what Luke does, which is amazing? He writes a story of a man and then the story of a woman. A man, a woman, a man, a woman throughout the whole gospel. But not only does he do that, he writes the story of a Jew and then an outcast. A Jew who would have status in their eyes, and then a very low status person. So not only does he mix man and woman, he mixes high status and low status, high status and low status. The genealogy of Jesus in the Gospel of Luke is not like the Gospel of Matthew, for example. In the first verse of the Gospel of Matthew, we get the big names for the Jews, right? We have the son of David, the son of Abraham, first verse of Matthew. But in Luke, the genealogy of Jesus is traced all the way to Adam. Because if you're a human being, you're included in the plan of salvation. Aside from that, he is the one that shows how radical and outrageous the grace of God really is. Because he's so inclusive, and 40% of Luke is not found in any other gospel, he has parables and events that are only recorded in his gospel. All the stories in which outcasts are heroes are only in the gospel of Luke. For example, the Good Samaritan, only in the gospel of Luke. The prodigal son parable, only in the gospel of Luke. This man, undeserving, spent his money on prostitutes, squanders his father's inheritance, only in the gospel of Luke, is received back with a big hug from the father, even though he's absolutely undeserving. And the dialogue that we will see today is Jesus and the thief on the cross, which is the enactment of the parable of the prodigal son. When Jesus is on the cross and the thief asks for part of his inheritance when he comes into his kingdom. So all these things are only in the Gospel of Luke. That's why the Gospel of Luke has such joyful, amazed, and exuberant responses to the good news. So now that you're experts in the Gospel of Luke, I'm going to take you to the beginning of the Bible, and this is where we're going to start our time together this morning. So please go to Genesis chapter 1 with me. Now, Genesis chapter 1 is the chapter where God one day decides he's going to have children. Perhaps you remember that day when you and your spouse sat down on the kitchen table and said, what do you think? Is it time? Is it time for us to have children? I know that some of you didn't plan and still had children, but most of you actually one day said, what do you think? Do you think it's time? God decides he's going to create a world for his children. Genesis 1 is the creation of the world. And every day, from the second day on, God makes a qualitative statement about what he has done as he prepares this beautiful room, this beautiful world for his children. And he says, and it was good, second day. And it was good, third day. It was good, fourth day. It was good, fifth day. And then on the sixth day, something happens. Let's read it. Chapter 1 of Genesis, verse 26. We have what is called a divine dialogue. It's the only time in all of creation narrative where we have God speaking among themselves in the Trinity. Chapter 1, verse 26. God said, let us make mankind in our image. Let's do this. We've been waiting for this a long time. We created the perfect world, and they are talking among themselves. God said, let us make mankind in our image, according to our likeness. We're going to have children, says God. And the report comes on verse 27. God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. And that day wasn't just good like all the other days. Oh, no. Having a pet is good. Having a garden is good. But when God had children, he had to call that day something different. Verse 31. God saw all that he had made, and behold, it was very good. Your Hebrew has a superlative there. It's not just good like all the other days. This day when God had children is very good. It's unusually good. It's good in a great way. It's the day that God had children in his image. The word image is not a strange word. It's the same word that will be used later when Adam will have a child in his image in Genesis chapter 5. So it's not a weird, strange concept. God had children in his image. Adam had children in his image. Genesis 5. You have children in your image. In the likeness of. And God got so excited with his children. The same way that you got excited the first time you had your babies. He said, I'm going to make a special room for them. Yes, the world is perfect, but I'm going to make a special room. Like you prepared that nursery and you painted it pink and blue and whatever is it that you did. God did that too. He said, I'm going to create a garden just for them. Even though the whole world is perfect, I'm going to create a garden for them. And God created a garden for his children. Chapter 2, verse 8 of Genesis. The Lord God planted a garden. Now, many of you know that the Old Testament, which was written in Hebrew, eventually got translated into Greek. We call that the Septuagint. The Septuagint was translated about 200 years before Christ came. So the New Testament writers and Jesus and many of them used the Greek version of the Old Testament. Well, you know what the Greek word for garden is? The Lord God planted is paradiso. Paradiso. What English word do we get from that? God planted such a beautiful place that is called the paradiso of God. And there he put man whom he had formed. And out of the ground, the Lord caused all kinds of trees, but not just to eat. Look what it says here. Tree that is pleasing to the sight and good for food. And in the middle of this paradiso, God placed the tree of life. This tree of life would be a symbol that his children were eternal the way he was. He is, and he will always be. And his children in his image were also eternal. And they had a visual aid every day. They would grab a fruit. We don't know what the fruit was. Today we're going to use an apple. But they would, in this paradiso, they would grab every day a fruit from this tree of life to remind them of their connection with the life giver and who they were. They were eternal, and they were going to live with him forever. That was the plan. So they used to eat from the in the paradiso from the tree of life every day for eternity. Wouldn't it be great if the Bible ended there? But the Bible starts there. Because the Bible is the report of the plan of salvation from beginning to end. And it starts there because in chapter 3, the kidnapper comes along. I don't know if any of you have had your children kidnapped. I certainly hope you haven't lost a child. There's no pain greater than losing a child in this life. But I've seen people in the mall, mothers or fathers, who lost their child for a couple minutes. Have you seen somebody in the mall that has lost a child? Desperate. They'll stop you. It doesn't matter how they're dressed. It doesn't matter who they are. All that matters is that they lost their child. They'll stop you, show you a photo. Have you seen my child? I lost my child. And you know what? When the kidnapper came along in Genesis chapter 3 and convinced the children of God with the same tactics that kidnappers use today, he convinced them and said, oh, no, your daddy doesn't want what's best for you. Oh, no, I have what's best for you. So follow me, okay? Human beings follow the kidnapper. And God responded in the same desperate and passionate way that you would have if somebody took your child. Sometimes we get lost in the translation, but the first promise in Genesis 3:15 is directed to the serpent in the presence of Adam and Eve, but is told to the serpent, and it says this in the Hebrew, I will crush your head. I mean, you better believe you have that type of God. Who, when the kidnapper came and took the child away, what would you do? Would you say, oh, yeah, you can take my child away? No, you wouldn't. Well, God didn't either. He said, I'm going to crush your head. I'm coming back. You're not going to get away with this. Yes, you will hurt us, but we're going to crush your head. I'm coming back. I refuse to go throughout eternity, says God, without my children. So I'm coming back. At that moment, we have the first part of what we call the covenant, where God said, I'm getting my children back. Unfortunately, they lost access to the tree of life. Chapter 3 ends when they lose access to the tree of life, and they have to leave the paradiso. And this would be a very sad story. Now, when we get to the book of Revelation, something amazing happens. We're back at the tree of life in the last chapter. Okay, the Bible is called, is what is called an inclusio. This is an academic word, I-N-C-L-U-S-S-I-O. I'm going to say it again. I-N-C-L, inclusio. I-N-C-L-U-S-I-O. It means a sandwich, a narrative sandwich. Book ends when something starts and ends in the same way. The first three chapters of Genesis, I reverse exactly in the same order in the last three chapters of Genesis, of Revelation. Same thing, reversed. Chapter 1, created world. Chapter 2, God is in intimacy with his children. Chapter 3, sin comes in. Revelation 20, sin is eradicated. Chapter 21, God is back with his people face to face. Chapter 22, the world is recreated. So when we get to the book of Genesis, of the Revelation, which, by the way, is a book of worship. Did you know that? There's 16 scenes of worship in the book of Revelation. It's a revelation of Jesus Christ and the end of the great controversy that was possible only through the blood of the Lamb. 404 verses in English, 518 allusions to the Old Testament. All the Old Testament is coming, and God says, ta-da, I won. And I got my children back. So when you start this book of Revelation, immediately you start hearing the same language that you had in Genesis. For example, chapter 2. Let's go to chapter 2 of Revelation. We start getting the same words in the Greek that were used in the Septuagint, in the Greek Old Testament, at the beginning. So Revelation chapter 2, for example, we're in the seven churches, verse 7. Revelation chapter 2, verse 7. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, and in Revelation that's very specific, to hangs on to faith in Jesus till the end, I will grant to eat of what? Of the tree of life. Ta-da! It's back. And the tree of life is where? In the paradiso, exact word that was used in Genesis chapter 2. So as we start looking at this book, we start realizing that God actually wins. We get full circle from the beginning to the end. What we lost in Genesis, we get back in Revelation. Chapter 21, for example. We get this intimacy back. You know this very well because we always repeat it. Verse 3 in chapter 21, I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be among them. This is the covenantal formula that God kept repeating throughout the Bible. I'm their God. They're my kids. I'm coming back for them. Don't forget, I'm coming back. I'm coming back. I'm paying their ransom. And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will no longer be any death. No longer any mourning or crying or pain. These things have passed away. Look at verse 7. He who overcomes will inherit these things, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. Finally, we're going to be back together, says God. When we end Revelation, in the last beatitude, because the book of Revelation has seven beatitudes, in the last and seventh beatitude, chapter 22, verse 14, blessed are those who wash their robes so that they can have the right to the tree of life. Okay, so we start in Genesis. We lose this. So we are in Revelation. We're back at the tree of life, eating from the same fruit, back in the paradiso, full circle. So when did this happen? When did God actually save his handicapped children? When did God take the bike and say, I'm going to do for you because you cannot do it for yourself. I'm going to save your life. So Genesis, we lost it. Revelation, we have it back. The promise comes immediately. I'm going to crush your head. I'm coming back. I'm getting them back immediately. When does this happen? Okay. Before we go to when it happens, I need to tell you a concept that has changed my life, and for many of you, it will be new. It's the concept of the Goel, G-O-E-L. Write this down. This will be the main word you'll ever learn, G-O-E-L. Goel. Let's repeat it together. One, two, three. Goel. A little louder so I know you got it, okay? One, two, three. Goel. There you go. It's like Noel for Christmas, but with a G. Goel in Hebrew means kinsman redeemer, closest of kin. Kinsman redeemer, closest of kin. We have a whole book in the Bible written on this concept. What is it? Very good. But we have missed the fact that the whole Bible is built on this concept. Let me tell you what it is. The kinsman redeemer, the closest of kin, had five roles. I'm going to tell you what they are. The first one was, if your closest relative became enslaved and couldn't pay their debt, the kinsman redeemer came and paid that price, paid the ransom, and redeemed them out of slavery. So the first role was to pay the price of the relative. Number two role, to get the property back from the family. For example, if you had to give away the property that belonged to your family because of debt, the kinsman redeemer, the Goel, could come and actually pay the price of that property and get it back to the family. Number three, he would appear in court instead of you. Number four, you could actually get descendants for a dead brother by marrying their widow so that your line didn't stop there just because the brother died. The other brother would pick up and have children in his name. Number five, he would avenge the blood of the relative. Okay, this is the punchline. Oh, I can't wait to tell you. When God created us in his image, he became our closest of kin. I'm going to repeat that. When God created us in his image, he became our closest of kin. Therefore, he obligated himself to a rescue package if anything happened to his children. So the main name for God in the Bible, especially in the prophet Isaiah, is Goel. Every time you read the word redeemer in your Bible, you're actually reading the word Goel, where God is saying, do not be afraid. I have goeled you. I have called you by name. You are mine. Don't be afraid. I paid the price. And Jesus Christ becomes the goel. And that's all five roles that are from the biblical goel. Not only does he pay our price to get us back, but he pays the price of our land. That's why the new earth is here, because he got it back. All the roles, if we had a whole week to talk about the Goel, we wouldn't exhaust this topic. Because the whole Bible is built on the fact that because God created us in his image, he became our closest of kin, our Goel, and obligated himself to getting us back, getting our land back, appearing in court instead of us, buying descendants from God. When the whole dead was raised, that's why Isaiah 53 says he will see the descendants and be satisfied. And he avenges our blood against the one who caused all these problems, the kidnapper. Of course, he said, I'll crush your head. I'm coming back. When did this happen? For this, we're going to the Gospel of Luke. The concept of the Goel is so powerful. It's so strong and it's so complete that perhaps you never lived with the assurance of salvation until today. Perhaps you did not understand that at the cross, God did not just say, I might save you. I know a lot of people preach a weak gospel. The weak gospel, which is not gospel at all, says you might be saved. That's not the gospel of the Bible. And it starts from Genesis 3, and it says, I'm coming back, I'm crushing your head, I am not going to live eternity without my children. Revelation, we're all there, because he did what he said he did. He's the Alpha, he's the Omega, he's the beginning and he's the end. And he says in Revelation, it is done. And on the cross, he says, it is finished. So let's go to the Gospel of Luke. Come with me to Luke chapter 23. This is the moment when the Goel is about to pay the price. This is the moment that all the Old Testament is pointing to, and the moment that all of the New Testament is trying to interpret for us. This is the moment. Luke chapter 23. Now, you're experts in Luke, because we just discussed Luke, so you know that this dialogue, that is a radical dialogue of grace, the radical dialogue of the thief on the cross with Jesus, happens only in the Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter 23, verse 33. Actually, let's start on verse 39 because our time is going fast. Verse 39. One of the criminals, the word criminal is interesting in the Greek, is kakurgoi. It's made of two words, kakos, which means evil, and ergo, which means work. So he's a worker of evil. That's all we know about these two men. One of the criminals who were hanged there was hurling abuse at him, saying, are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us. But the other answered, rebuking him, saying, do you not even fear God, since we are under the same sentence of condemnation? And indeed, we are suffering justly for what we have received. We are receiving what we deserve for our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong. And then the most outrageous request that we have in all of the New Testament comes next. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Three parts of the request. Jesus is part of the request. You know what Jesus means. The angel's message is still ringing in our ears. He will be called Jesus, for he will save his people from his sins. Jesus means Yahweh saves, the Lord saves. So even the name of Jesus is already a request for salvation. Remember me. What does remember me mean? It doesn't mean have memory of me or put my portrait on your desk. The verb remember in the Old Testament is when God remembers his people, he's about to act on their behalf in accordance to the covenant he made from the beginning. So he's saying, Jesus, you who save, please do something about me. When? When you come into your kingdom. What a strange thing that this man who was being crucified next to him realized that the cross was not the end, and that the cross was in fact consistent with his messiahship, that after the cross was the kingdom. But see, if you look at it like this, when you have a child in his image saying, you know, I've been bad. My grades were bad. I don't deserve anything from you. Could you please buy me a car? I mean, imagine your child saying, you know, I had a bad year, bad grades, buy me a car. Can you imagine you saying, of course, honey, I'll buy you a car and I'll give you a bigger allowance next year. The only thing more outrageous than the request was the answer. The answer didn't say anything like, of course I'll give you a car, I'll remember you. The answer said, a car? I'll give you a red Ferrari with a mansion to go with it, $10 million allowance per month for eternity. That was the answer. And the answer is so strong, so specific. I know we spent many years trying to realize where the comma was on this coming verse. So we actually lost what it says. Let's read verse 43. And he said to him, truly, I say to you today, you shall be with me in paradise. Okay, let's learn this. Let's first of all see how the Greek is. Truly, I say to you today, with me, you shall be in paradise. That's the Greek. The Greek doesn't have any commas, so you don't have to worry about that. But aside from that, the order is the one I just told you. I say to you today, with me, you shall be in paradise. Okay, let's analyze this. This is the Son of God who is in his image, asking for an inheritance. And Jesus knows that this man is a kakurgos. He does not have anything. He's an evildoer. He doesn't deserve. But he's been waiting for his children since the foundation of the world. Since that day when he said, I'm going to crush your head to the serpent. Since that day, he's been waiting to embrace back his children for good, for eternity. Like you would if you lost your child. So at that moment, with the eagerness of a parent who is about to save a kidnapped child, Jesus says, truly, truly, amen, amen, in the Greek. Let's analyze the four parts of the answer. I say to you, number one, today. Okay, you can't have it both ways. If you don't believe that today had to do with going to paradise that day, then you have to believe that Jesus was saying, today you can have this assurance. Today, you don't have to wait till my kingdom comes to know if you will be with me in paradise. If the today had nothing to do with Jesus going to paradise with this man on that day, then today has to do with you can have the assurance of salvation today. I will give everything I have so that you come out of this place saying, today I got it. Today I know. Today I will live with the joy of my salvation from this day forward. Today, says Jesus, honey, today you can know that you will be with me. Second, you will be. The verbal tense is not you might be. Let me think about it. Show yourself good for 2 years and I'll tell you. You will be. You will be. The third part I want to emphasize is the word that now you know by heart. Paradeisos. Paradeisos, says Jesus. You will be with me in the paradeisos. The same word in Genesis chapter 2 and 3. Same word in Revelation. Now, says Jesus, this is the moment when I'm reopening the path to the paradeisos. This is the moment, says Jesus, when that path that you lost to the tree of life, honey, is being reopened and you will be with me in the paradeisos. Do you know that this is the only time in all four Gospels that Jesus uses the word paradise? The only one. It's not that he used it all the time. He's the only one. And the first person promised a bite. A bite from the tree of life. The first person ever was the thief on the cross who did not deserve absolutely anything. Exactly like you and me. And that day, Jesus says, you can rest assured. You know why? As if my child stays there. Because today, I'm assuring you that paradise is reopened. So you can rest on this. You will be with me in paradiso, okay? So don't forget, you can rest on this. Rest. But there's one more part. And the part is the center part of the Greek sentence. You know, in the Greek, the center of the sentence has the weight of the sentence. And in the Greek is with me. With me, says Jesus. I am your ticket. It's not because you did good. It's not because you deserve it. It's not because, oh no, God knows, you are so handicapped. It's because you're going to be with me. I'm your ticket. You know, some time ago I was watching a television news about something that was happening in the Middle East. And this preacher came on. And he talked about a trip that he took with a very high-profile religious political figure to a Middle East country. And he said that during that time, they arrived to this country, and the security was so tight that this man was left behind, and the important person kept going. And he said, I'm part of the group. Please let me in. And nobody would let him in. And he thought he got to come back to the United States without doing what he went to do. But all of a sudden, this man, who was about 200 yards from him, the important man, turned around, and he yelled, "He's with me!" He says that all the security parted like the Red Sea. And I walked, he said, saying, "I told you I was with him." You know, I can't wait. Sometime from now, this Kakurgos is going to be walking the streets of gold. Actually, let's do it like this. Soon, I will be walking the streets of gold. And many of you who have known me and know my failures will say, "What is she doing here?" I can't wait. I just can't wait for Jesus to turn around and with tears in his eyes saying, "Well, she is with me." Can you imagine that moment when Jesus turns around and says, "My baby is with me because I am her Goel, her closest of kin, and you know what? We're never, ever going to separate again." I can't wait for that hug. I can't wait for that day. But what would it be if all of us understood that Jesus actually, our Goel, our kinsman redeemer, actually has purchased on the cross our salvation and has purchased our land and has purchased our freedom? What would it happen to the Oregon Conference if all of you got this? You will go out saying, "Our Redeemer has done it. And we're going home. This is the joy of our salvation." Sometimes we go with such a sad face going, "Okay, I'm bringing you good news." I don't want what you have, if that's what you look like. I want the woohoo! We're going home. Because he has done it. And he opened paradise and the tree of life. And we're there very soon. Yes, that's right. Woohoo! That's right. You know, I'm going to give you a tip and a resource. Pacific Press has asked me to put this whole concept of the Goel in a book, which was the sharing book for this year. We have some free ones at VOP stand that we will give this afternoon. But if you don't get to that, the ABC has them. It's called Surprised by Love, the Unexpected Rescue of God's Children. And the whole book explains the Goel concept from Genesis to Revelation. The desperation of a parent who has lost his children and is coming back for them and has paid their price. You know, I thought that I had understood the gospel. You know, I was born in the Adventist Church. My father was the White State Director for the General Conference. You know, I knew things. I knew the doctrines, and I knew a lot of things. But it was through hard times that my religion traveled from my head to my heart, the 13 longest inches that you'll ever have to travel. And I understood the gospel not only because I went deep into the scriptures, but because one day I saw an enacted parable of the gospel. You know, preachers are always looking for something to show that will capture what they're trying to say. There's nothing I could show you that could capture the deepness of the Goel concept and the plan of salvation, nothing. But the closest I came to it was the story of the Hoyt team. Many of you have heard of the Hoyt team, have seen them on the website. The Hoyt team is a team of father and son who run marathons together. The father carries the handicapped son to the finish line every time. And it all started many years ago when the child was young and they entered a 5K marathon and with a wheelchair. The father carried the son. And The child is so handicapped, he's quadriplegic. He cannot even move his hands or legs with coordination. So they created a computer for him to type with his forehead. They put a little thing here and he can type because he's very intelligent. Now he's a young adult. And they entered this race. When they crossed the finish line, the father saw a big smile on this kid, but couldn't know what it was. And they couldn't wait to get home. And so when they got home, the son typed and said, "Dad, today when we crossed the finish line, it was the first time I felt like a winner. I felt like I wasn't handicapped, like I could walk." And the father said, "Oh, my child, we're going to go to every possible marathon. We're going to run all of it. I'm going to train and carry you through." They've been running for years. This year, the father turns 70, and they're running the Boston Marathon. But the day I saw the triathlon in Hawaii in a documentary, the triathlon called the Iron Man, 126 miles of biking, 26.5 miles biking, 126, 26.5 of running, and 2.5 miles of swimming. And this man carried his handicapped son through the whole thing until they crossed the finish line. That day, I understood the gospel. I understood that I am that handicapped child, and that my father, the closest of kin, carried me through the finish line and said, "It is finished." Our Goel took us in his hands, carried us through. He said, "It is finished." And if you really believe that today, something will happen inside of you that you won't be able to stop. You will want to tell everybody. See, I only have one message, and it's this one that I can preach from every verse of the Bible, but it's always the same one. Jesus died because he's our Goel, and he paid my price, and we are going home. Woo-hoo is right. Now you get the chance to proclaim that you are redeemed, that you are goeled, that you are free. When you get this, you know what happens? You will live at the foot of the cross and will dedicate your life to this proclamation that the goel did his job and he's coming back for us. So what you say, let's stand up and let's sing "Redeem," how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Goeled by his infinite mercy, his child, and forever I am.
Redeemed through his infinite mercy, his child, and forever.
and I'll receive a blessing from the Lord. May our every thought, our every doctrine, our every prayer point us to the cross. May we understand that our Goel has paid a price and is coming back for us. Lord, what I would give for every person in this place to walk away with assurance of their salvation. Through your blood, the high price you paid. Lord, may our hearts burn with this assurance that we may go and proclaim it and hasten your coming. Because, Lord, I can't wait for that hug. When with tears in your eyes, you'll say, "Welcome home, children. I was so desperate for you, and you have come home for good." Oh, Lord, what a day that will be. Make us start living that joy of our salvation today, because we will be with you in paradise. We ask it in the name of our Goel, our kinsman, Redeemer, who has done his job, Jesus Christ. Amen.